So we are thrilled to have Dr. Matt Dawson join us today. Dr. Dawson combines his obsession with longevity and performance optimization with his training in genomics and functional medicine to give personalized, precise medical guidance to maximize health, a health span. Whether it's a professional athlete or a grandparent optimizing their mental clarity and mobility to keep up with their grandkids, Dr. Dawson is passionate about helping everyone perform at their absolute peak. So, Matt, please join us. Wow, babe. You make my heart sing. You make everything
groovy. Wow, babe. So, Charles, Doro, Trisha, this is the coolest conference I've ever been to. Is it not amazing? So I was a little worried that walking down as a physician to Wild Thing would be seen as too weird. And then last night at dinner, Charles and Davis led us in a 3.5 minute meditation while we were holding hands before dinner. And I saw what transpired this morning and I realized maybe Wild Thing's not weird enough for this group. but I don't think weird is the right word. The right word is different. And that's exactly what medicine needs right now. So we chose wild to describe the kind of health that we're trying to achieve because wild means a couple different things to us. First off, it's a allusion to wild as in wilderness and nature. Things that we forgot about in medicine. When I see a patient with anxiety, a lot of times I find that they will get more out of forest bathing than they will an SSRI. When we see patients with depression, chronic pain, PTSD, autism, Alzheimer's, heart disease, these things respond just as well to nature, to gardening, to sauna, to love, to social connection as they do pharmaceuticals frequently. And we've forgotten that in medicine. The other problem with medicine, in my opinion, is not only has it left a lot of ancient truths behind, but is frequently 20 years behind the actual cutting edge science. If you look at the best science coming out of some of our best universities and institutions, you find things like genomics, which is really powerful. A lot of peptides we're discovering, which can do incredible things. You look at the aging research, some of the brand new aging research that's came out, I honestly believe now that aging is mostly optional. I'm actually 97 years old. That's true. So no, it's actually not true at all. But I do think when I see people just be resigned to the fact that we're going to fall apart as we get older, the evidence doesn't support that. It really doesn't. Just in the last couple months, so there's something called the Horvath clock, which is a really cool test that looks at DNA methylation to measure your biologic age. It was discovered by this Israeli researcher. In the last couple months, a couple studies have came out where they've actually reversed aging in people with certain cocktails. So that's brand new research, so medicine will start implementing that probably 20 years from now. And that's not good enough for us. So what we do, the best description of what we do at Wild Health is genomics-based personalized medicine. It's kind of a mouthful. So before I dive into the medicine and science, I want to make sure you all understand a couple key concepts, some prerequisites. How many of you have heard of DNA? Okay, good. All right. How many of you understand the concept that you are genetically unique and different than the person next to you? Perfect. All right, so we're all on the same page. You've met the prerequisites, so I can start with the talk. So if I can get my slides up. No, I'm just kidding. I don't have any slides. I just like to mess with the AV people sometimes. They've done a great job, and I just like to just make their heart go quick a little bit. So we've had great slides and great research and evidence by Dr. Freeman and by Kristen and by Tammy. So I'm just going to tell you some stories. And the first story I want to tell you is when Mike Mallon, Dr. Mike Mallon, my co-founder in Wild Health, when he and I realized there was a better way. At the time, we were associate professors at universities. We were treating patients. We were also teaching a lot of physicians. We were teaching point-of-care ultrasound, which was a technology that had incredible potential, but not many doctors knew how to use it because it was new. So we formed a nonprofit. We were teaching a lot of physicians in resource-limited settings as well because it had really tremendous potential in those settings. And we were traveling a lot. And I was at a conference, and I got a text from Mike. And it was his cholesterol. And it was really high. And at the time, we were doing ultramarathons. We were eating what we thought was perfect. We thought we were really healthy. And this wasn't just like a little bit high. This is like, man, you're going to die in the next 10 years of a heart attack high. It was pretty scary numbers. And he texted me because he knew I was obsessed with nutrition, nutritional research, and how to affect change with food. So I immediately texted him back. He's like, okay, look, based on all the evidence, all the biggest meta-analyses, this is the diet that's going to probably have the biggest effect on your lipids. 85% of people do better. So he started eating that way, and he got worse. His physician at the time wanted to start him on a statin, which we were a little bit hesitant just because of all the problems with statins, but his numbers were so high, he went ahead and started. And he had incredible muscle breakdown and myopathies, all these bad side effects. And about that time, we started seeing that the research on genomics, it was probably ready for prime time. So we had our own DNA sequenced. We started reading up and researching. And we pretty quickly realized that the diet that he should be on was exactly opposite of what I told him to be on. We also saw he had a single nucleotide polymorphism that made him almost guaranteed to get muscle breakdown and myopathy from a statin. And it made us angry at first, like, why did his doctor not know this? And then we realized that his doctor cared about him. He was trying to do the best thing. This wasn't his doctor's fault. This was a problem with our system. This information was out there, but there was no way to get it out to people. It's a broken system. I got a very vivid reminder of that a couple of months ago. I went to California to visit my wife's grandmother. I met her 12 years earlier. She was a wonderful, vibrant woman, so kind, full of life. I have four children. We took our 10 and 7-year-old daughters out to meet her for the first time a couple months ago. She didn't recognize any of us. She had Alzheimer's disease. The only thing that she said while we were there were, shut up, stupid, get out of my house. And we left with my children scared and my wife in tears. And any of you who have been a part of this or seen this disease, you've seen how horrible it is. And you know how sad it is. At the same time, I had a little more than sadness. I was angry again because there isn't a pill that works, but you can do something about this disease. It's a lifestyle disease. I know that you can actually prevent it and even treat it with lifestyle things, the things that we've talked about today. And I don't know that just because I've seen the literature on it. We have experience with this. My grandmother was diagnosed with Alzheimer's about a year ago. When she was, I convinced her to come see me. My mother, who I love dearly, obviously, I got her to get tested genetically, and she had an APOE4 mutation, which puts you at several times higher risk for Alzheimer's. She also had metabolic syndrome, insulin resistance, a really bad picture coming together, and I was honest with her, and I told her, Mom, Violet, our one-year-old, if you want to recognize her at her high school graduation, you need to make some changes. And so I started treating both my mother and my grandmother. And the way we treated them was the exact same way we treat everyone, whether it's a professional athlete or whoever it is. I think medicine has really failed when you see someone with dementia, for example, and you focus just on the brain. Or someone with heart disease, you focus on the heart. A knee problem, you focus on the knee. We're not a collection of organs or organ systems. We're a whole being that needs to be treated in a holistic way. So we started with genetics. We sequenced their DNA. We looked at all their single nucleotide polymorphisms, the things that make them unique, give them the advantages or disadvantages. Genetics are important. Honestly, more important are epigenetics, how you turn on and off those good and bad genes every day, what you eat, what you do for exercise, your social situation, your stress level. So we do a deep dive into where their health is right now as well with a lot of blood testing. We look at lipids, but also lipid fractionization, which is much more prognostic, the hormone levels, thyroid, vitamins, minerals, all of those things. And then the microbiome, which you just heard about. The microbiome in the last 5 to 10 years we found out is tremendously important for everything from mood, body composition, brain health. Most of your serotonin, as we just learned, is modulated by your gut bacteria. When it comes to body composition, you may have seen the studies with mice where they take germ-free mice raised in a bubble with no microbiome, and they give half the mice a microbiome of an obese person and half of a lean person, and the mice fed the exact same thing get obese or lean based on their microbiome. And they can switch the microbiomes and switch the body composition of the mice. Autism, I heard a couple people mention that earlier today as well. A fascinating study. We know there's a very big link with Alzheimer's, autism, any type of brain disorder between the gut microbiome and the brain. There was just a study that came out in the last year on fecal microbial transplants, giving kids with autism a completely new microbiome. In that study, 2 years later, the kids who got this procedure done, 48% reduction in their autism symptoms. They classify them as mild, moderate, severe autism. At the end of the study, 44% of those children no longer even classified as mild autism. So they didn't say we cured autism. You don't want to go that far and say it. But what is autism? What is Alzheimer's? What is depression? It's a collection of symptoms which we can have a major impact on. Once we have all of that data, the genetics, the microbiome, the lab testing, then we add on a really unique technique that's extremely powerful. It's not used in medicine very much at all. We actually read about this in some ancient medical transcripts. So you may have heard of it. I'm not sure if anybody ever heard of conversation. No? So you all probably see the same doctors I've seen, so no. That's probably the most important part of what we do. It's fun to talk about the genomics and microbiome, but talking to the patient, you get incredible information which you have to have. What is your day like? What time do you wake up? What do you eat? When do you eat? What do you do for exercise? What's your family life? What's your social situation? How much stress do you have? What kind of mindfulness practice do you have? What is your spiritual practice? These things are extremely important. Our goal is to come up with an optimization plan for you. But to do that, we have to have that information. When we come up with the perfect diet for somebody, it's somewhat based on their genomics. If you have a PEMT polymorphism, then you need more choline. If you have the MTHFR, like we talked about, you need some methylfolate. However, your lab tests, if you have the PEMT, you need more choline. Okay, eggs and fish are the two best sources of those. But if you have really high TMAO levels on your lab test, that could be harmful. Or if you just hate eggs and fish, then that's not going to work. If I give you a perfect diet for you and it's something that you're not going to eat, that you don't have access to, that you don't know how to prepare, that your family's not going to eat, it's a waste of our time and your time. The same thing with exercise. We can look at your muscle fiber types and see what you're going to respond best to, endurance or strength training. We can look at your proclivity to get injured and come up with exercises to avoid that. We can also look at how much recovery you need. But what's most important for your longevity and health is what you enjoy doing. Like, we need to know what you enjoy doing, and then we can build around that. And then we want to be very goal-focused, very objective and data-driven, and identify what are our goals. A lot of times medicine, I think, skates by. You see your doctor, they'll give you a recommendation, and they see you 6 months later, and it's kind of all on you from there. We don't want to do that. We want to say, what is your goal? How are we going to measure success? When are we going to measure success? And then we adjust quickly in real time. We can do that with lab testing. My grandmother and mother, for example, my grandmother, the main goal is her cognitive functioning. So we did a MoCA score, Montreal Cognitive Assessment, to get a score on her. She scored a 16 out of 30. The average for an Alzheimer's patient is 16.2, so she was right in the middle. And my mother, her goal was to lose weight. The patient's goals are the most important thing to us. I also wanted to decrease her hemoglobin A1C, fix her metabolic syndrome, fix her inflammation. Inflammation, a lot of people have termed the coin inflammaging. Inflammation drives aging process and all of chronic disease. So I came up with a list as well. And then how do we measure those? How exactly are we going to test? When are we going to test? What is success and what's not? And how do we iterate and change those parameters and move forward if we're not having the success we want? We get so granular as to measure daily. Have any of you ever heard of the Oura Ring? So this is maybe my favorite possession I own. Every morning I wake up and I have sleep lab quality data on my sleep. I know how much deep sleep, REM sleep, my entire sleep architecture. And I found, I always thought of health as kind of three legs to a stool. There's nutrition, there's exercise, there's sleep, there's also all the other things that come along with that we talked about today, mindfulness and stress reduction. But I always focused on the fitness and the nutrition part, and not as much on the sleep. But I honestly believe now it's not just as important, but the most important. It's honestly the biggest lever I have to pull and affect everything else. And so when we want to optimize sleep, we want to figure out how we're going to do that and do experiments. We want to do N of one experiments. For example, when I first got my Oura Ring, I was getting 10 to 12 minutes of sleep per night. And sleep is something that, just to talk about the scope of the problem, every year when we do this crazy experiment in the United States called daylight savings time and we lose an hour of sleep, rates of heart attack and stroke spike in the ER. So to think what we're doing to ourselves chronically by being sleep deprived is pretty scary. Body composition, if you want to lose weight and you're in a calorie deficit state, if you're sleep deprived, your body preferentially goes after muscle and breaks it down. And if you're not, it goes after fat. It's incredibly important. Exercise, you're obviously not going to exercise as well if you're sleep deprived. If you do, you're many times more likely to get injured. So we really focus on sleep. I was getting 10 to 12 minutes of deep sleep a night. We really want probably an hour at least. So I looked at my genetics. I have an MTNR1 polymorphism that's related to melatonin receptors. So melatonin would probably help, and it did. Made a big difference. I had an FAAH SNP, so CBD would probably be good for my sleep. I took it, had a big difference. And we can add things on one at a time in a data-driven way where we get a baseline in 7 days of a treatment. Does it work or not? If it doesn't, quit spending your money on it. Don't waste your time. Let's move on to the next thing. We can even pull out so far, as I mentioned, the aging thing. With the Horvath clock, we'll frequently send a DNA age test on our patients to see what their biologic age is. And whether or not they realize it or not, one of my goals is always to kind of send that again in a year, 6 months, and try to have that coming back the other way. But be objective and data-driven about that as well. So how did my mother and my grandmother do with this? They had very individualized plans, different diets, different exercise. We created a social system around my grandmother. It's very difficult to enact change for someone who has cognitive decline. But I saw her again in 3 months. Her goal was to not progress, not get worse. If you've had a loved one that's had this disease, you're told, get your affairs in order. Just try to slow the progression a little bit with medications. So she went from a 16 to a 20 on her MoCA score. A lot of times I hesitate to say that because I feel like people won't believe me who are in this field because they think that's not possible. But we're seeing results like that when you really apply a personalized, holistic approach. My mother at 3 months lost 40 pounds. Her insulin resistance, her metabolic syndrome got better. Her CRP was undetectable, her inflammation, which is what CRP is. And the most meaningful thing to me was when she told me she felt 20 years younger. And she looked 20 years younger. And honestly, she was 20 years younger. I probably have 20 more years with my mother if she keeps up this routine that she's doing. So this is really working, and why do I tell you this? So I'm not telling you to brag and say how smart we are. Because let's face it, it doesn't take a genius to realize you should treat people individually based on their genetics in a holistic way and have conversations with your patient. That's not groundbreaking. But why is medicine not doing it? So that's why I'm here. I've gotten really tired of asking that question and then just shrugging my shoulders. I don't know why. Maybe it will. So I'm having a lot of fun treating patients in this way, having good results. It's enjoyable. But our goal now is not to do that, but our goal now is to start a revolution. I'm really here looking for more revolutionaries to work with us. Because I'm going to make a confession to you right now, something that bothers me about what we're doing. It takes a lot of time, and I can only see a small number of patients. I started out limiting myself to 100 patients, and then I found that that was too many with as much time as this took. So the problem with seeing a very few number of patients are most of my patients are professional athletes or CEOs, and people where I grew up in rural Kentucky can't afford this service, and that really bothers me. My mother and grandmother are getting it because I love them. But this should be democratized. Everyone should be able to do that. And I can't do that alone. Our group can't do that alone. We're developing some technology. We've taken a lot of the algorithms that we've created, and we've hired some informaticists and some data scientists. And we actually have a product now where the 5 to 7 initial hours that we were spending as physicians is 60 seconds. We're uploading some data, we're getting some algorithms back, and then we can just have the conversation and treat. So I think we're very close, a few months away from being able to apply this to 10,000 people at a time. In which case, imagine when you could take 10,000 employees of a company or 10,000 teachers and optimize their health, or firefighters or policemen or military personnel, the difference that you can make at scale like that. But we need more help, we need more providers. So what we're doing now is we've transitioned a little bit. The Ultrasound Leadership Academy, the nonprofit I started to teach point of care ultrasound, we're replicating that exact same model to teach physicians this. And your physician cares about you. They want to learn this, but it's difficult, so we're trying to create that. So if you're a provider and you want to learn this, we're working. So I want you to reach out to me. I would love to talk to you more about it. To be honest, the quickest way that this can accelerate, though, is by just health consumers, patients kind of demanding it. Doctors want to do a great job. It's just hard to learn new stuff when you're out and you're really busy in practice. And most of the time, you don't unless you're forced to by your patients. So talk to your doctor about this. Or I'll talk to your doctor about this for you. I love talking about this. I'm going to give you my email address right now. So it's very easy to remember. It's matthew.dawson@wildhealth.com. That comes directly to me. If a lot of you email me, it may take me a few days to get back to you, but all of those come to me, and I would love to talk to you about this because I'm very passionate about it. The system has to change. We haven't even started talking about pharmacogenomics, which is... Any of you have heard of Plavix? Plavix is the second most prescribed medication in the world. 30% of people who take it have a genetic variation that makes the enzyme not work properly in the metabolism. And those people who have that genetic variation are several times more likely to die of heart attack and stroke, which we're usually trying to prevent. Every medication is affected by your genetics and pathways. And how many of those 30% of people know what their genetics are? Close to zero. And it's not just medications, even supplements. I was asked specifically to talk about CBD because it's kind of a passion of mine, being wild health, any type of plant medicine or something somewhat more natural we're excited about. But CBD has a genetic pathway as well. CBD is something that I got pretty excited about a couple years ago, kind of went down a rabbit hole on when I started seeing the research, had a lot of patients coming to me who wanted to take it. But I got very worried because it's a supplement, it's a completely unregulated industry. And because of that, I actually found some farmers in Kentucky. Kentucky is the best place in the world to grow hemp. I met some chemists who were doing all the testing for farmers in the state who could tell what farmers had which pesticides or chemicals in the product, and I wanted to know that. These chemists, one had a degree in molecular biology from Princeton and a PhD in genomics from UC San Diego. The other one had a PhD in plant physiology from the University of Kentucky. And they were doing this testing. They had a biotech lab, and they also were extracting. And I connected them with these farmers so that I could get a product that I could give to my patients and take myself. Now, I tell you that because I think it's very important to tell you that I have a conflict of interest. I am an investor in Wild Health CBD, and integrity matters and conflicts matter. So anything I say positive about CBD, look at me kind of sideways, do the research yourself because I have a conflict. So because of that, I actually want to tell you some of the things to be worried about, some of the issues around CBD, because it's not candy, it's a plant medicine. It drives me nuts when I see orange sickle flavored CBD and CBD gummies and things like this, because it's not candy, it's a plant medicine. I could tell you story after story of patients with anxiety, chronic pain, musculosclerosis, autism, people who have had good results, and a lot of the research backs it up, not enough research. But I also would like to tell you about a patient that I have who 3 years ago had a psychotic break from taking CBD because of the product he got that was tainted with something we still don't know what. It's completely unregulated. So here are the dangers and risks, and if you're interested in CBD, here's what you need to know. Where you get your CBD is the most important thing. It has to be from someone you trust. If you find a brand you like, got a pretty box, that's not good enough, go to their website, look for their COA, or certificate of analysis. If they don't have one, don't buy it. There are plenty of companies out there now. Try to get someone on the phone and talk to them from the company. If you can't, go to a different company. There are plenty of companies out there. When you find someone you trust, the dosing matters. People are consuming this like it's a supplement and not a medicine, but the dosing matters. There'll be bottles 500 milligrams per 30 ml, 1,500 milligrams per 30 ml, 4,800 milligrams per 60 ml. You can get anywhere in a 1 milliliter dropper from 5 milligrams to 100 milligrams, and that's a big difference. Know what you're taking it for. If it's for pain or anxiety, dosages of 5 to 20 may work. If it's for a lot of the studies in autism are 1 milligram per kilogram, and a kid that's maybe 30, 50, 70, depending on the size. The sleep studies, about 150 milligrams is what is shown in the studies to work for me. 50 to 100 works well for sleep. For Dravet syndrome or refractory seizures, it's 10 milligrams per kilogram or 500 to 700 milligrams. That's a big difference. So talk to someone who you trust, your doctor, a pharmacist, someone else before you take this supplement, which is really a powerful plant medicine. The risks to watch out for. Not a lot of this is published, but I've talked to some of the leading researchers in the field. For example, someone I know who's doing the biggest study on autism and CBD, and he's actually told me that they've seen some LFT bumps or liver function test increase at 1 milligram per kilogram. So dosages of 50 to 70 to 100. So if you're going to be taking this chronically at those types of doses, you should have your doctor follow along and test your liver function test and make sure everything is going well. It's a drug that has really great potential, but anything that's efficacious and works has some side effects and some drawbacks as well that you need to know about and be careful about. I could talk to you for a long time on CBD because I'm interested, but I don't want to because I have that conflict and I feel very weird talking to you about it. So we do have a table in the exhibitors back there, and there's someone there that can talk to you more about it. What I'm really passionate about and want to talk to you about even more is genomic-based personalized medicine. So CBD itself, there's a genetic component, which I mentioned. There's a SNP called FAAH, or fatty acid amide hydrolase. That's an enzyme that breaks down anandamide, which is an endocannabinoid, your body's own CBD that it produces itself. There's a lady in Europe who has an FAAH SNP and zero activity of that enzyme, so really high levels of anandamide, where she can't feel pain at all, which is a pretty dangerous thing. Personally, I have a very rare form of that. It's about 1 in 144 chance of having it, and I have the lowest levels that you can have without a real genetic mutation of FAH. So what that means, my mother loves to tell the story of when I broke my arms when I was a kid and I didn't cry. So I have a high pain tolerance, not because I'm tough, but because I have this specific polymorphism. My wife, who's a child and adolescent psychiatrist, she sees a lot of kids on the autism spectrum, and then an adult board certified as well, who sees a lot of people with anxiety. I used to talk to her about anxiety, saying, you know what, I feel like I'm an empathetic person and I'm good with people, but I don't even understand the concept of anxiety. And then when I got that test, I realized it's because it's almost impossible for me to feel anxiety because of that. So CBD does not work for me for pain or anxiety because of my natural levels of this endocannabinoid and my enzyme. But if you look at the research, my variation of FAH responds pretty well to sleep. And that was one of my clues to try it for sleep and get a really big increase in my deep sleep when I take CBD. You don't have to know your genetics to try CBD. The cool thing is that information is actually just in your raw data if you've done a 23andMe or an Ancestry.com. You can download your raw data, you can look up the RSID code, and you could figure this out and see where you are. Or talk to your doctor or someone else who can help guide you through that process. If you don't want to go through all that trouble and you want to try CBD, make sure it's a company that you trust. Do the math on the dosing. Start low and go slow. It's not candy. It's a plant medicine, and we should treat it as such. I've been told I'm out of time. So if you want to contact me again, matthew.dawson@wildhealth.com. I'm going to be at our table at lunch. I would love to talk to you some more as well. Medicine does have to change. My wife's grandmother deserved better. My grandmother and my mother deserve better, and you deserve better as well. If you want to join me in the revolution, send me an email. I'd love to talk to you some more. Thank you for your attention.